Good morning and greetings in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Before we begin this morning's worship, I have a number of announcements to bring to your attention. Some notes for today. The VBS registration closes today, so if you haven't done that, we'd ask you to do that as quickly as you can today before the end of the day. Also, there is a volunteer meeting today at 5 p.m. in the choir room. So I ask if you are a volunteer to make sure that you come to that. If you're not able to come or not able to participate, one of the ways you can help is to make snacks. And that is because we have a number of volunteers and we have breaks throughout the day that give the chance for the volunteers to go in and get a break from the kids and take a time to relax. And if they have some snacks there, that's a great encouragement. If you're not sure what to bring, talk to me. I'm one of the volunteers and I can tell you what snacks I like. I'd be happy to pass that along to you. So if you can help that way, that'd be great. There is a Sunday school location change today. So if you are in the Hoyle, Scott, or Harris shepherding groups, today you will be meeting in room 134, which is right across from the gym. So that's the Harris, Scott, Hoyle shepherding groups. You'll be meeting in room 134 instead of in the alcove here. If you're in the XYZ group, you are now back in the alcove. As people have been coming back after the whole COVID issue, numbers have been changing here and there, so we're trying to accommodate everybody. So again, XYZers, you will meet in the alcove today during the Sunday school hour. Also today, we have our pie fellowship. That's tonight. Following the PM service, we're going to have a time of eating pies together. If you are one of those that's bringing a pie, we'd ask you to bring it to the kitchen between 5:30 and 5:45. That gives the ladies there a chance to organize all of them and put them into the proper place for us afterwards. So if you can, come tonight. Great time to meet other people. If you're visiting with us, you are certainly welcome to come and to enjoy a time of fellowship together. This week, a couple of specific announcements regarding this week. There will be no men at the gates this week. So for all you men who come on Tuesday mornings, you get a break this week. Also, Wednesday night, we'll have our usual activities, but specifically to note is the junior hires are going to do a yogurt walk. So you junior hires that will be coming, make sure you bring some money for that. Also, next Sunday is our fifth Sunday meal, our fifth week. We have 5 weeks in a month. We reserve the fifth one for a time of fellowship and a meal. So we encourage people to bring food. And after the Sunday school hour, we all meet together for a great meal together down in the fellowship hall. More information will go out about that, about what you can bring and where to bring it and what time. That will be coming out during the week. If you're visiting with us, we'd ask you to fill out one of those blue cards in the pew rack in front of you. That's always helpful to us to get to know you. If you'd like to just give it to us afterwards, you can put it in the offering plate if that's easier for you. Also, for the visitors, we do have an intro class. It's a 15-week cycled class. You can jump in at any one of those and just catch into the group. You don't have to start at the very beginning. This morning, Lord willing, we're going to be talking about the Lord's Day. What is Woodruff Rhodes' position and understanding of the Lord's Day from Scripture? And we'll be talking about that today, so I invite you to come to that. Finally, this morning, we will be singing a new song. You should have picked up the song sheet on your way in. The choir is going to sing it for the introit this morning to give you an idea of how that song is to be sung. And so as they sing this morning, you'll want to pay attention to that. And finally, with all the discussion about inflation, Marxism, critical race theory, Israeli and Hamas conflict, it's good to be reminded as we come together of God's sovereignty. Listen to the words from Psalm 47. The Lord Most High is awesome. He is a great king over all the earth. He will subdue the peoples under us and the nations under our feet. For God is the king of all the earth. Sing praises with understanding. God reigns over the nations. God sits on his holy throne, for the shields of the earth belong to God. He is greatly exalted. Knowing these truths about God, how should Christians respond? Well, we read in the same psalm these kinds of responses. Oh, clap your hands, all you people. Shout to God with the voice of triumph. Sing praises to God. Sing praises. Sing praises to our King. Sing praises. How do we respond? We rejoice. In just a moment, we will be called to worship and to do that very thing, to rejoice and to enjoy our God and his sovereign reign over the earth. Prepare now for worship. Lord calls us to worship this morning from Psalm 81, verse 1. Sing aloud to God our strength. Make a joyful shout to the God of Jacob. Well, let's do this together. Let's now sing to the Lord. Please stand as we sing together. Hymn number 98A, that's Psalm 98A, found in your Trinity Psalter hymnal. Please remain standing for our confession, our corporate confession of sin. And today, we are going to use a hymn to confess our sins together. So we'd ask you to please turn to hymn 179, Forgive Our Sins as We Forgive Hymn 179. Let us sing our confession together. God's word of pardon from Isaiah 43, verse 25. I, even I, am he who blots out your transgressions for my sake, and I will not remember your sins. Amen. You remain standing for the reading of God's word. The Old Testament reading this morning is found in Psalm 91. Psalm 91. Hear now the word of God. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In him I will trust. Surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of the pestilence that walks in darkness, nor of the destruction that lays waste at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place, no evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over you, to keep you in all your ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent you shall trample underfoot. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. Please be seated. I'd like to ask the Wong family to come forward to the front of the sanctuary. Along with them is their elder, Joe Harris, who is ordained by the church to provide spiritual counsel and prayer for the Wong family. Coming forward, we have Frank and Martha, Camilla and Barry. If you'd like to see their Chinese names, they're in the bulletin. I will not be using them. I don't want to butcher them, so I'll be using their English names for this morning. Frank, Martha, and Camilla met with the session and gave testimonies of their faith in Christ. And this morning, they come before you so that they can witness their testimony to you. Barry, on the other hand, comes as a non-communing child, and once we have brought them into membership, we are going to have the joy of baptizing him. What are some of the reasons and benefits for joining and being a member of the church? We read in Scripture as well as in our confession some of the qualifications, some of the benefits of joining the church. First, we see that membership recognizes a distinction between God's people and the world. It makes that distinction between the two peoples. Membership in the church also gives the believer an authority structure that encourages and prays for them. Membership in the church is a way to commit to the exercise of your spiritual gifts in ministry and service among the body of believers who have also committed themselves to you. Membership provides a distinct identity with God's people, the protection of authority and opportunity for service, and as well, community membership also gives the believer admission to the Lord's table. For these reasons, and in response to the biblical pattern and teaching regarding membership, we welcome these new members into our fellowship this morning. Let me ask each of you then to respond to the following questions with "I do." Do you acknowledge yourself to be a sinner in the sight of God, justly deserving his displeasure and without hope save in his sovereign mercy? Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and Savior of sinners, and do you receive and rest upon him alone for salvation as he is offered in the gospel? Do you resolve and promise and humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit that you will endeavor to live as becomes the followers of Christ? Do you promise to support the church in its worship and work to the best of your ability? Do you submit yourself to the government and discipline of the church and promise to study its purity and peace? Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for the Wong family, for bringing him here from China to bring Frank into a chance to learn a greater education, understanding of his faith as he goes to school and studies more about the faith. We pray for his family that they would benefit from those studies, but also, Father, we pray that they would be benefited from their presence here in this church. May we be a great encouragement to them and they to us as we join together in mutual service in your kingdom. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. The Reformed practice of baptizing children is in keeping with the Old Testament practice of circumcision, where children were included in the covenant people of God. These children, even before they were able to articulate their faith, took a sign that identified them with God's people. Yet it was incumbent upon them to own the covenant themselves when they got older. God never rescinded the practice of including covenant children in the visible church, the visible membership of God's people. Thus, we see that children are sanctified by parents in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 7. We see multiple references to household baptisms in the New Testament. And though God did not change his working through covenant families, he did change the sign so that now we perform baptisms rather than circumcisions. And this sign can also be placed on the daughters as well, showing the expansion of the kingdom. Baptizing children is a picture of the faith of the parents. At the same time, in keeping with the Old Testament practice, we still call our children to faith and repentance. And when they are older, we call them to publicly confess their faith and to acknowledge their desire to join the church invisible in order that they might also partake of the Lord's Supper. So let me ask the parents, Frank and Martha, the following questions, and please answer with "I do." Do you acknowledge Barry's need of the cleansing blood of Jesus Christ and the renewing grace of the Holy Spirit? Do you claim God's covenant promises in his behalf, and do you look in faith to the Lord Jesus Christ for his salvation as you do for your own? Do you now unreservedly dedicate Barry to God and promise in humble reliance upon divine grace that you will endeavor to set before him a godly example, that you will pray with him and for him, and that you will teach him the doctrines of our holy religion, and that you will strive by all the means of God's appointment to bring him up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? Children of believers are covenant children, part of the covenant community of believers. And if you are a communing member of this church, you are not just individuals who happen to be congregating. You have covenantal responsibilities. As such, we would ask, if you are a communing member of Woodruff Road Presbyterian Church, we ask that you stand now to publicly acknowledge your willingness to assist in the nurture and admonition of Barry by responding to the following question with, "We do." Do you as a congregation undertake the responsibility of assisting the parents in the Christian nurture of this child? Please be seated. Barry, come on over here. I told him all he had to do is stand here and smile. And he's doing a good job so far. He's got a great smile. Barry Wong, child of believing parents, child of the covenant, and heir of the promises of God, I baptize you now in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Father, thank you for Barry. Thank you for his great smile and his great attitude. We pray, Father, that his presence here in the church among all the other boys and girls will be a great memory for him as he grows and remembers the times of instruction and fellowship and fun here at the church. May you bless him and his family, we pray, in Christ's name. Amen. Welcome. You bet. I get you wet enough. The move from a vertically oriented worship to horizontally oriented worship is very strong in our culture, particularly a culture that is seriously considering Marxist philosophy and practice. The shift is even reflected in many pulpits now, in which ministers spend more time crying for social justice, horizontal, than biblical worship of the true and the living God, vertical. This isn't new. We read in Matthew 26, verses 7 through 9, the following, that a woman came to him having an alabaster flask of very costly, fragrant oil, and she poured it on his head and as he sat at the table. But when his disciples saw it, they were indignant, saying, "Why this waste? For this fragrant oil might have been sold for much and given to the poor." But Jesus responded the following way. He said, "For you have the poor with you always, but me you do not have always." I wonder how many pastors now would find those words offensive. Does this mean that Woodruff Road then is uninterested in helping the poor among us? Of course not. We have an offering every time we have the Lord's Supper, and our deacons every year wisely and biblically distribute to those in need among us. But as we give now, let us give with the glory of God foremost in our thoughts, that the Lord will use his tithes and offerings for the spread of the gospel of the kingdom of God. Let us pray. We ask, Lord, that you take these tithes and offerings of your people, that you use them to magnify the name of Christ throughout the world, for we pray in the name of Christ. Amen.
Please join me in prayer. Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but unto your name give glory. You are a holy and omnipotent and omniscient and sovereign God, and no flesh shall glory in your presence. Even as the angels in heaven circle your throne and proclaim you holy, 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 we on earth now fall down before you in worship. As we come before you now, our desire is to direct all praise and glory to you. You created us for this very purpose, for you made us in your image to enjoy communion with you. And you called us for this purpose, for you said, I will be your God, and you shall be my people. And this praise and glory to God will be our occupation for all eternity, when we join with 10,000 times 10,000s of your saints, saying, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And so now, as we sit in your house, as we gather with your people, as we hear your word read and preached, we praise you as our Lord and our God. We praise you, God, for your works of creation. By the word of your power, you made all things and all very good. We thank you for ordering your creation with labor and rest and marriage and families. Lord, make us faithful to your command to be fruitful and multiply, to fill the earth and to subdue it. We praise you, God, for your works of providence. For you are God and there is none else. You are God and there is none like you. You declare the end from the beginning, and from ancient times things not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will accomplish all my purpose. And all your works of providence have an end. The good of those who love you, those who are the called according to your purpose. Father, cause us to live out the implications of this truth. Purge us of worry and anxiety and fear and hesitancy. Lord, among your people here, there are those who have cancer. There are those who need employment to put food on their tables. There are those who are lonely, those who have children who are living in sin and rebellion, those with difficult marriages, those who have lost a spouse or a child. Lord, we would not face these trials as those who are enslaved to sin and worry and despair. Rather, embolden us to live as Christian men and women with confidence as we suffer tribulations. Cause us to say with Paul that we will rejoice in our sufferings because of the great hope we have in you. Remind us that you will not leave us or forsake us. And no matter what may befall us, no matter how much we may suffer, this truth is constant, that our cups run over with your blessings. We praise you, God, for your mercy to us in Christ. We were your enemies, but you loved us. We were polluted by sin, but you cleansed us. We dwelt in darkness, but you brought us into your marvelous light. Lord, you saved us. And who were we? Not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble, but you chose us, the foolish things of the world, to put to shame the wise. And you chose us, the weak things of the world, to put to shame the things which are mighty. And you chose us, the base things of the world, and the things which you despised, and the things which are not, to bring to nothing the things that are. Lord Jesus, in all this, you became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness, and sanctification, and redemption. We who glory, we will glory in the Lord. But Lord, we ask now for more and more of your grace. Pour out your sanctifying grace on us. Pour it out through your word, through the sacraments, through our prayers, and use even our fellow believers here today to sharpen us. Lord, even bring your fatherly discipline on us to drive us away from our sin and closer to our Savior. Reveal to us the blackness of our sins and strengthen our will and our resolve to put them away and live holy lives before your face. Lord, we also seek your mercy in our weakness and in our suffering. Pour out your mercy, especially on those who are even now afflicted. Do it, Father, to relieve their suffering, but even more, that you may be seen and known as a God of mercy. And in pouring out your mercy on those who are afflicted, in answering the prayers of your saints, show your power and your goodness to those around us who do not know you. Open their eyes that they would see and their ears that they would hear, so that they would turn to you and that you would heal them. We praise you, God, for your church. You have promised that your church will not perish, but to the contrary, she will go forth to the ends of the earth. Lord, sustain and prosper your church here at Woodruff Road. Lord, keep us from pride. Grant us humility. We are totally dependent on you, Holy Spirit, in every work that we do here. Without your wisdom and power, we would quickly descend into sin and error. So, Lord, keep us faithful to your word as our only rule of faith and practice. Strengthen and encourage and equip our ministers, Pastor Robbins, Pastor Dodds, Pastor Anderson. Supply us with more elders and more deacons to serve in your church. Work in all our hearts, Lord, to awaken us to the gifts you've given us. Bring forth teachers and comforters and laborers and prayers and ushers and singers and all those who serve the work of your church. And Lord, we seek your grace and favor for our children. Prosper them under your word. Call them to saving faith. Raise them as a generation stronger than we, a generation of mighty men and women who will resist persecution and who will build your kingdom. And Lord, we see now your church being built in Peru and in Brazil and in Honduras and in Germany and in Hungary and in Haiti. Strengthen those ministers of your word who even now labor to bring your counsel before the nations. Bless their labors. Encourage them. Use them as the means by which you bring millions upon millions of people into your kingdom. And Lord, as your kingdom advances, cast down and destroy those false gods that Satan has raised up to rival you. Overthrow Islam and paganism and materialism and apathy and indifference. And Lord, hasten the day when your glory is revealed in its fullness, when you come with power and might, and when everyone who has ever lived will bow the knee and will agree with this truism, Jesus Christ is Lord. When that day comes, Lord Jesus, may we be found among those who will inherit the kingdom prepared for them from the foundation of the world. But until that day, cause us to labor exhaustively so that we might be fit servants in your sight. We pray these things, Lord Jesus, as your humble servants, but we pray them boldly, with confidence that you will do all that you have promised, for with God nothing shall be impossible. Lord Jesus, yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Because God's word is infallible and inerrant, we reverence it by standing as we do our reading. So we ask you to please stand now for the New Testament reading found in John chapter 15, verses 1 through 7. Hear now the word of God. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine. Neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch and is withered, and they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Well, let's now sing that handout that was given to you as you came in the church this morning, Holy Spirit, Living Breath of God. Let's sing together.
The Lord's Day is only beginning. Immediately following the benediction of this service, invite you to fellowship and to sit under outstanding teaching. If you don't know where to go, you can find the room number in your bulletin. And then tonight is an outstanding time of not only fellowship, immediately following the preaching of the word, pie fellowship. I have it on good report that there are already several lemon pies promised, and so it will automatically be a good evening. And then we will be continuing in our series in the life of Samuel. That begins at 6 p.m. Certainly hope that you'll be a part of that. For the first 30 years after the cross and resurrection and ascension and Pentecost, the church exploded in growth and rapidly spread throughout the Roman Empire. And even though there was some resistance and minor persecution, the church largely found a warm reception. This was especially the case in Ephesus, the capital of Asia. But in Acts 19, we read of the massive impact the gospel first had and how many people made professions of faith. The church grew in Ephesus. That all began to change in AD 64 when Nero burned Rome and blamed it on the Christians. And this began a wave of general persecution that spread throughout the Roman Empire. Suddenly, being a Christian became dangerous, even deadly. It was a sifting time for the church. Marginal Christians rapidly abandoned the church rather than suffer. Now, let me say that again, because I'm not trying to be a prophet. I'm just telling you what happens when the church is put under fire. In the first century, in the wave of Nero's persecution, marginal Christians left the church in droves. Mass apostasy. So concerned were they for personal safety, they began to disavow any connection to the gospel. They apostatized, no longer confessing Christ. In his letter to Timothy, Paul lists the names of some of the most prominent of the apostates. There they are in Holy Scripture, given by the Holy Spirit: Phygellus, Hermogenes, Demas, Alexander, Hymenaeus, and Philetus. The roll call of the apostates, there it is. People who did not abide in Christ. People who didn't persevere, didn't go all the way to the end. Now, in his farewell discourse that we're going to be looking at today, Jesus in John 15 tells us not only will there be apostates in every generation, but he also tells us what will happen to them. You'll remember, if you have your Bible open to John 15, and I hope you do, because I certainly want you to see in the Word what God is saying. You'll remember that Thursday evening began when Jesus gathered his disciples in an upper room to celebrate Passover in Jerusalem. He begins by washing the feet of the 12, prophesying that Judas would betray him that night. Jesus gives the new commandment to the disciples, telling them to love one another as he has loved them. He prophesies that Peter will deny him three times before sunup. He comforts the disciples with the promise of an eternal heavenly home. He tells the disciples how to get to that heavenly home through him, the way, the truth, and the life. He repeatedly says, "If you love me, you'll keep my commandments." He promises the Holy Spirit to his disciples. He promises the Spirit will come and indwell and teach the disciples all things and bring all things to their remembrance. And then at the close of chapter 14, I hope you see those last few words hanging on the end of chapter 14, where Jesus tells the disciples, "Arise, let us go from here." At that moment, Jesus and the remaining 11 disciples — Judas has already left on his errand of demonic practice — he tells the other 11 to get up. They go down the side stairs of the upper room. They head out down the streets of darkened Jerusalem, across the brook Kidron, towards the Garden of Gethsemane. And on the way, Jesus continues to teach them lessons, profound lessons. In fact, the first 7 verses of John 15 could almost serve as a template, a guide for spiritual experience. And so I hope you'll be listening very carefully. Let's seek the help of the Spirit now. Sovereign Lord, you've given this text, these words that we'll examine, expound, and apply. You've given them by divine inspiration. And you have promised us that these words will be profitable for us. They will profit us for doctrine. They will be of great profit for reproof and for correction. They will give us profit for instruction in righteousness, that all of us might be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. So take this word this morning. Press it home to our minds and hearts. Transform our practices. Deepen our trust in Christ and strengthen our love to Him. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Hope you're looking again at John 15. And you'll notice that there we have, as I pointed out last week, an extended metaphor. And in this metaphor, you have 3 characters. Look at them there in the first 7 verses of John 15. You have the Father. He is spoken of as a horticulturist. You have Jesus, who is the true vine. And then you have us. Everyone in this room is a branch of some sort, either a living branch or a dead branch. Now, why this figure of speech? I'm fascinated by why Jesus uses this metaphor. Because Jesus is saying that unlike Israel in the Old Testament, who was a failed vine, he will be the life-giving vine to the people of God. And he asserts, look at it in verse 4 and 5, he asserts twice that apart from him, men can do nothing. They can't satisfy the justice or wrath of God. They can't change their own heart. They can't even believe the gospel apart from God's gracious gift of faith. And so Jesus talks about that first major point in verses 1 through 7, the vital connection — theologians call it union with Christ — between himself and all true believers. His life empowers us. And then we, the branches, bear fruit. Fruit, of course, are those godly character traits listed in Galatians 5, love, joy, peace, and so on. They are the only proof that a man is truly united to Christ. Men can protest all day long and say, well, Carl, I know there's no evidence. I know there's no growth in character. I know that I'm still that same old knucklehead I've always been. But I really am saved. I've got the card to prove it. I walk the aisle. I met with the session. I'm a member of the church. Therefore, I am on my way to heaven. Jesus rebuts that at every turn, especially in the Sermon on the Mount when he says, by their fruit, you shall know them. Fruit is what comes as a result of being in vital connection, union with Christ. The reason why I wanted to take last week and this week to look at this text is I want us to look at two more important vital spiritual concepts in verses 1 through 7. Look carefully and you'll see them there. One is the issue of pruning. The other is the issue of abiding. And I want us to dig deep in terms of your spiritual experience. Of course, there are always armchair hearers who say, I wish Carl would give more nuances to the Greek text, quote a few more old dead writers. But what I want you to do is listen and answer this question. Do I know anything about what Carl is speaking of? Anything of these experiences that he speaks of, pruning and abiding? Look first at the issue of pruning. Remember, we have a garden metaphor going here. And so I want to ask this text several questions and answer them for you. The first is, who gets pruned? Look at verse 2. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes. In other words, all those who have a vital connection, all those who have saving union with Christ, have his life flowing from him to them. Every one of them, every fruitful branch will be pruned. And I dare say there are some, perhaps in this room, many, who've been pruned by the heavenly horticulturist, and you don't even know that's what happened. And what I want to do today is I want to undergird your experience with scriptural explanation. Some of you right now, this week, are being pruned and you don't grasp what the Father is doing. So let's ask several questions about this subject of pruning. Again, the first was, who gets pruned? Every fruitful branch. Every Christian who is producing those 9 godly character traits listed in Galatians 5, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Every one of you who has those traits, they're progressive and growing. By the way, if you don't know this, this is Sanctification 101. We believe in progressive sanctification. That when the Holy Spirit comes in and dwells, he begins to sanctify you more and more and more year by year. Do you know what that means? That means the people in this room who by profession have walked with Christ for 40, 50, 60 years ought to be the humblest, sweetest, most self-controlled, loving, gentle folks. One of the things that's incredibly hard to deal with pastorally, to watch, are people who are in their 70s and 80s, and they don't get better, they get bitter. They get grumpier and angrier. Get those kids off my yard. And there's no growth in sanctification. I was, by the way, always one of those kids on the yard getting chased off. But we believe in progressive sanctification. There are evidence that the Holy Spirit is within and at work. That's who will be pruned, those who are bearing more and more and more fruit. So what is pruning? Perhaps, and I hope that I still have your attention at this point, you're thinking, well, what is this? Pruning, let me give you a textbook definition and then spell that out. Pruning is the removal of anything that's detrimental to maximum fruit bearing. Let me say that again because that definition is actually important. Pruning is the removal by cutting off of anything that is detrimental to maximum fruit bearing. When Sandy and I first came out of seminary and we took a call in this presbytery in Walnut Grove, South Carolina, South Spartanburg, Just down the road from us in the community was a vineyard. And this fellow had designs upon starting a famous winery in Walnut Grove, South Carolina. And come pruning season, he hired a crew of master pruners who he flew out from Napa Valley to come and do the pruning. Well, if any of you know anything about rural communities, anytime some other fellow's doing something new and interesting on his property, all the other guys come and stand around and watch. And so I went with a couple of the deacons over to this fellow's vineyard to watch. Now, all the guys who I was hanging out with that day, they knew about pruning and growing peaches, but not wine grapes, and they wanted to see it. And so here come the master pruners from Napa Valley, and they have tool belts full of cutting tools, and they begin to go and surgically cut and prune these vines. And by the time they were through, it looked like hardly anything was left. And so I wanted to understand. I wanted to grow in my broad general knowledge. And I said, why are you cutting that stick and that branch? And over again, these fellows answered, because if I don't, this vine won't yield the best kind of grapes, the maximum fruit harvest. That's what Jesus is speaking of right here. You may be undergoing difficulty today in your life. God is pruning you. Maybe you're undergoing economic difficulties. And so God is cutting off the dead wood of self-sufficiency. Or maybe you're undergoing physical problems. God may be snipping off your love for this present life and helping you to look forward to your eternal state with Him when there will be no more pain, no more crying, no more death. Or perhaps you're undergoing horrible family problems. God may be chopping off the limbs of lack of reliance on His counsel concerning parenting and marriage. Now, here's the part that I want you to be fascinated by. Who does the pruning? Look carefully at our text. Because the easy answer is, and of course the kids who sit in your back seat on the way home, your 7 and 8 year olds, when you start asking questions, they always know that the right answer is always only one of two answers. The right answer to any question dad asks is, God or for His own glory. That's always right, kids. You can't go wrong with one of those. Got a 50-50 chance. Well, I want you to notice who does the pruning. And kids, if you say to your mom and dad on the way home, well, God does it, be more specific. We're Trinitarians. It is the Father, the first person of the Trinity, who sends trials and affliction for your good. In fact, we're told this repeatedly. Look at verse 1 and verse 2. We're told, my Father is the vine dresser. In other words, the one who does the pruning. And then again in verse 2, every branch in me that does not bear fruit, He takes away, and every branch that bears fruit, He prunes. This is Jesus talking here. Now let me stop and make us be a little bit more inherently Trinitarian. So many Protestant believers would say, oh yeah, I'm Trinitarian, but they're really functional Unitarians. Because they never speak of the work of the Spirit. That's scary. They think somebody might think they're a crazy charismatic if they do that. And they never speak of the work of the Father because they're kind of dumbfounded. Does the Bible say anything about the Father? And so they're functionally Unitarian because all they know and understand is the second person of the Godhead. One of my heroes is Benjamin Morgan Palmer. If you go in my office, there's his picture, a very unattractive man. And so it makes me feel good about myself to have his picture in my office. And he's sitting there on the wall looking at me, telling me not to be silly and foolish, but to preach the word. But Benjamin Morgan Palmer, his marvelous book on Trinitarianism is called The Threefold Fellowship. And Palmer says, there should be in every Christian's experience a recognized fellowship with each of the three persons of the Godhead. And he goes on to spell out and say, here's how you should experience and know the Father. Here's how you should experience and know the Son. Here's how you should experience and know the Spirit. And so let me tell you five ways you should know the Father. And yes, one of them is as your pruner. Five ways. The first is, you should know the Father as your sovereign elector. When we say, well, God chose me from before the foundation of the world. Well, actually, let's be a little more specific than that. We are repeatedly told all through the Bible that it's the first person of the Trinity, the Father, who chose you. Listen to how Paul puts it in Ephesians 1. He says, "Blessed be the God and Father who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. He chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world. He predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself according to the good pleasure of his will." What you see all through the New Testament is specifically, it is the Father who chooses. And so when you rejoice in gratitude for your eternal election, it's the Father to whom all praise is due. The second thing the Father does for every believer, we must relate to the Father as our adopting Father. One of the beauties of this congregation, one of the delights, is to see it every Wednesday night as you see just this horde, this wave of kids in the yard and in the gym and on the playground and the Gaga pit and other games I don't even know the names of. And to look and see how many of the children of this congregation are adopted. That's so because their parents have gotten a hold of this. They've understood that since God has adopted us, we should turn around and show our love to those who are in need of parents. But specifically, our adopted Father is the Father. Listen to what we're told in Galatians 4. "When the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman under the law, to redeem those who are under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. Because you are sons, God sends forth the Spirit of his Son into your heart, crying out, Abba, Father." The second way we relate to the first person of the Trinity is not just as our electing Father, but as our adopting Father. The third way we relate to the Father, we relate to the Father as the one who keeps us. Jesus, and we'll see this in a couple of chapters in John 17, in the high priestly prayer, Jesus is concerned that his disciples might slip away, that they might apostatize. And so he cries out to the one whose job description, his function is to keep the elect and not let them away. And Jesus cries out in John 17, "Now I'm no longer in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to you, Holy Father. Keep through your name those whom you have given me." Do you hear that? The Son asks the Father to keep the elect safe. Why should he do that? Because he's the one who chose them. And in John chapter 10, you remember what Jesus, his trump card is when thinking about the security of the believer. He says, "My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand." Do you know what the Father does full time? He keeps you. He guards you. He protects you from apostasy. A fourth function of the Father: we must relate to the Father as the one to whom our prayers are directed. You know, our generation, even among evangelicals, I didn't think I would live to see it. We have now taken on the silly, ungodly, unbiblical conversation of the world when we talk about prayer. And so you'll hear evangelicals who go to halfway decent Bible-believing churches, and they'll say, "Thoughts and prayers to you." And I always think, what are you talking about? To you? No, our prayers are never directed horizontally, they're vertical. In fact, they're even more specifically directed to the first person of the Trinity. Do you remember what Jesus taught in the Sermon on the Mount? He said, "Pray to your Father who is in the secret place, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. Therefore, in this manner, pray, Our Father in heaven." You know that Jesus never counsels thoughts and prayers to you, ever. He commands us to pray to our Father. So another way we relate to the first person of the Trinity is he is the hearer of our prayers. But the fifth, and we could go on, and I'll stop here. We see it here in our text. Look at verse 1 and 2. A fifth way we relate to the first person of the Trinity is He is our pruner. It is the Father who sees those needed areas of snipping. It's the Father who says, I see that habit of the tongue. I'm going to send someone to Him to rebuke him. It will be painful at first, but it will yield good fruit. Now, when you hear this at first, this business of pruning, you think, this sounds painful. I don't think I like this. Paul had the exact same experience. He's talking about his thorn in the flesh in 2 Corinthians 12, and that he asked the Lord to take it away, but the Lord didn't. So Paul says this, I now take pleasure in infirmities, persecutions, needs, distresses, and reproaches. Why? Because he knows the Father is pruning him then. Now let's ask the how question. Look at verse 3. How will the Father prune you? Jesus says, you're already clean because of the words which I have spoken to you. Now, you're going to have to do a little bit of work. This isn't too much work, but keep one finger in your Bible and turn backwards 1.5 pages to John 13:10, where Jesus says, right after he has finished or in the midst of washing the disciples' feet, and he says in John 13:10, he who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean, and you are clean, but not all of you. The interesting word there, when Jesus uses the Greek word for clean in John 13:10, it's the same word as used for pruning. And so what I want you to see is when Jesus says in verse 3, you're already clean or pruned, that would be more consistent with the context, because of the word. How is God largely going to prune the believer? Look at verse 3 of our text. By the word. He does this every Sunday. Often the Father simply uses the word to chasten us, prune us, convict us. And Christ is telling the disciples they've already been purged. They're pruned by the word. Unlike Judas, they've been cut back. Now they're ready to grow. Let me stop and ask you, do you even want to be pruned today? Do you want the dead limbs cut off? Do you want anything that hinders maximum fruitfulness to be snipped away? If so, let me tell you what to do. Sit under the Word of God morning and evening. Read the Word. Meditate on it. God will surely begin to trim away at you. Are you full of poor attitudes, sinful habits, unholy dispositions today? Be warned, don't listen to the Word or read the Word if you don't want to be purged. The writer of Hebrews calls your Bible God's pruning tool, a two-edged sword, living and active, cutting to the bone. And by the way, we are committed to using the Word as a pruning tool in every venue. And so we're committed to biblical counseling. If you sit down with Pastor Dan or Pastor Scotty, what the first thing they're going to do is they're going to pull out their pruning tool and start snipping away. And you might say, hey, Dan, Scotty, hey, I wanted somebody to make me feel good about myself and my rebellious habits. But they are the Father's assistants, bearing His pruning tool. Other times, the Father prunes by chastening and affliction. Either way, pruning hurts. Why does God want to prune you? Look back at verse 2. In verse 2, we read, every branch that bears fruit, He prunes, that it may bear more fruit. God is not interested. Oh, if I could say it 100 times. God's not interested in some sort of minimal fruit harvest or just a surface reformation of manners. He wants to keep cutting you so that you will blossom more with the glorious, expansive fruit of the Holy Spirit. And what I want you to notice is this isn't just Jesus in John. The apostles pick up on this theme. Look at Hebrews chapter 12, which ought to be a very familiar text. The writer of Hebrews is talking about chastening. That's a synonym for pruning. The chastening of the believer. But what I want you to get to is what it produces. Every time God chastens, afflicts, brings trials in the believer's life, what does it produce? Follow with me in Hebrews 12. Pick up verse 5. You've forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as to sons. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you're rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens, or prunes, scourges every son whom he receives. If you endure chastening, God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom a father does not chasten? But if you're without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you're illegitimate and not sons. Furthermore, we've had human fathers who corrected us and we paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? For they indeed for a few days chastened us as seemed best to them, but he for our profit, that we may be partakers of his holiness. Here it comes. No chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, afterwards, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. So when you're going through trials, pruning, instead of repeatedly and pointlessly saying to God, why? I can't tell you how often as a pastor I've dealt with people who are going through sharp trials. God is obviously pruning them. And all they can do is demand an answer of God. Why? Why is this happening to me? This should not be happening to me. And I tried in the most careful, pastoral, gracious way, say, well, the Lord has actually already answered the why question. It's in his word. He has told you repeatedly that the reason for these difficulties is to prune you, to cut you back, to strip away all the lifeless dead limbs so that you may bear a fruit harvest. By the way, you who are young and you're considering buying into the Christian life, let me just tell you what I want there to be complete truth in advertising. God will prune the believer for his entire life. It's a lifelong process. God never stops pruning the true believer. Don't fall prey to the unbiblical notion of, I remember when a young man said this to me, he was having a, in his mind, a very difficult time as a single man. He said, well, when I get married, then I won't struggle anymore. And I couldn't even suppress a laugh. I said, oh, my friend, that's when the struggles start. Or I've heard people say, well, you know, when I retire, my life will be easy. No, it won't. God has different pruning tools for every age group. He has different pruning for every season of life. Those struggles are sent by God to cut away the dead limbs. The greatest judgment God could bring you would be to let you alone and not work on you. To just let you go with your worry and your fear and your sharp tongue. I would say by way of application, oftentimes in trials, we call out to God and say, Father, where are you? You seem so far away, so distant. My friend, your heavenly Father's hand is never closer to you than when he's pruning you. That's when your Father is nearest. I would say as well by way of application, when a gardener does his pruning well, when Sandy and I lived in Memphis as college students, we had a bush. And I was going to hire Preston to come and cut that bush. And so Sandy wasn't there to give Preston direction. And so I stood out there and I said, so Preston, do you know what you're doing? Done it 100 times. I said, okay. He whips out his tools and he starts cutting. By the time he was done, the bush was this tall. And it had been about 5.5 feet tall. And Sandy, who loves all things green, flowers, bushes, all that, when she came home, I think I saw tears in her eyes. And she said, what have you done? I said, Preston knows what he's doing. She said, it will never come back. Sure enough, the next spring, it flowered even more. When a gardener does his pruning well, hardly anything is left but the vine. Similarly, the more we are pruned, the more of Christ, the vine, there is to see. It'll be a great help to you if you see each trial and affliction as the Lord pruning you for more fruitfulness. Notice who doesn't get pruned. Look at verse 2. The thing to note about fruitless branches is they get cut off, taken away. Who are these fruitless branches? Probably the first idea in the mind of the disciples is Judas, a man who had openly identified with Jesus for over 3 years. He'd heard all of Jesus' words, witnessed an endless procession of miracles, even saw Jesus raise a man from the dead. But he fell away. He was a dead branch, producing no fruit. Or as his fellow apostle John wrote, "They went out from us, but they were really not of us. For if they'd been of us, they would have remained with us. But they went out in order to be shown they were not of us." I want you to look at the second concept very briefly. The first one that we saw last week was union with Christ. Today, pruning. Now the third is abiding. And I want you to notice something. I hope you can count to seven, because what you will see in verses 4 through 7 is you will see the term abiding used 7 times. If you're a new believer and you're trying to get a handle on Bible study and you think, what would help me understand a text? What is this hermeneutics business you keep talking about? Well, one of the things for basic Bible study is if you're reading a context and you see a word repeated 7 times, that's probably a signal. That probably means it's an important concept. And in our text, it's the dominating term. Look at verses 4 through 7. You can count them up. 7 times Jesus uses the term abiding. What does it mean? What does it mean for you as a branch? Because this is the imperative in the text. What does it mean for you as a branch to abide in Christ? Easy clue by looking at the Greek word translated abide. It's the Greek word meno, and it simply means to continue, to endure, to stay, to remain, to cling. And so when Jesus issues the imperative in verse 4 to abide in him, he's commanding faithfulness, perseverance. When I was a kid in 5th grade, probably one of the greatest days of my life, my dad took my brother and I up to Kansas City to the old Harry Truman Stadium, which had wooden bleachers, on a July afternoon to see the Kansas City Royals play the Seattle Pilots, 2 expansion teams. In my first Major League Baseball game in person, and my brother and I were just tingling with excitement. My dad was a big baseball fan, but as we sit down in the bleachers, he was noticeably complacent. And my brother and I were kind of worried. We wanted to stir him up, and we wanted him to be as excited as we were. We brought our gloves, we brought our bats, our helmets, everything. And we kept saying, "Dad, won't this be great?" And Dad kind of yawned and said, "Carl, it's hard to get excited about the Royals and the Pilots," who, by the way, lasted 1 season as a franchise. He said, "It's hard to get excited about the Royals and the Pilots because they're both perennial cellar dwellers." I said, "Dad, I don't even know what that means. What does that mean?" And I was struck by it. It sounded like an impressive term, perennial cellar dwellers. And so he explained to me, perennial means always, every year. And cellar dwellers means they're in last place. They're at the bottom of their division. They never leave last place. They're always there. They're perennial. And I thought that was such a great term that I began to use it as an insult to my friends. "You're a perennial cellar dweller." If you can't insult your friends, who can you insult? But what Jesus is saying here is be perennial Christ dwellers. Make your abode with me and never live. And what Jesus is commanding here, stare at verse 4. What he's commanding here is nothing less than the perseverance of the saints. He's saying the way you persevere is by clinging to Christ and not let go. He's saying the believer is to say, "I am poor in spirit and Christ is rich in grace. Apart from him, I can do nothing. So I'm going to cling to him with all I have." How do you abide in Christ? By the means of grace. By putting yourself under the word at every possible opportunity. By the sacraments and prayer. The Lord's Day, fellowship and worship. You won't find Christ and abide in him outside of the appointed means. Did you hear that? If you're going to abide in Christ, it must happen by the use of the means, word, sacrament, prayer, Sabbath, fellowship, and worship. If you're not in the word and prayer, you're not abiding. In fact, abiding is a mutual thing. Look at verse 7. Christ says his word abides in us. And then earlier in John 8, we're to abide in his word. Abiding is simply a faithful enduring to the end. Paul uses this language in 1 Corinthians 15 when he says, it's a holding fast to the word. Or in Colossians 1 when Paul says, it's a continuing in the faith grounded and steadfast. Or John will write in Revelation 2 and he says, it's a being faithful unto death. Let me tell you what abiding isn't. Abiding is what we spoke of at the beginning of this sermon. It's a walking away from Christ. Perhaps the culture says, you need to leave now and get out while it's safe. Or you need to leave now and go find something more exciting. Abiding is not walking away from Christ, not using the means of grace. Some may identify themselves externally with Christ. Their names might be in a church role, but they're not persevering. How do we apply this word? Let me make a couple of applications. One is pruning shows up who really are the children of God. What is your response when pruning comes, when the trials come? Trials that are sure to humble you, which, by the way, it's always a good thing when God sets his hand to humble you. Sure to increase your prayerful dependence upon Christ. When pruning comes, you say, Lord, I want you to cut away the wicked habits of word and thought because my life's desire is to glorify you with all my waking moments. Or do you say, why? What good is a relationship with a God who can't keep pain and sadness away? In the parable of the sower, Jesus describes four types of hearers. One is the shallow ground hearer. And Jesus says of him, the minute that trials, tribulation, hardship, the opposition of the world come, they disappear. What effect do trials, pruning, and affliction have on you? Do they move you to run from God or to run to your heavenly Father? I would say as well by application, a solemn note. And my friends, you should be ready. Because as our culture becomes more and more opposed to the gospel, you are going to see more and more people, perhaps from this congregation, who will say, it's getting a little hot in here. I think I need to go identify, you know, with the Rotary Club or some other group because it's getting a little hot and I just don't need the trouble. Jesus is telling us there are going to be in every generation those dead branches bearing no fruit. Men and women who have some kind of outward identification with Christ. They were baptized, their family identity, their granddaddy was an elder, but they're not abiding in him. Look at Jesus' words and let it stay in your mind. These will be cast off by Christ. The message today, the imperative from Jesus is abide in Christ, cling to him, and never move away from him. Let's pray. Our Father, in light of this word that Jesus has spoken, we ask for persevering grace. And we ask that especially you would enable us to persevere when you begin to prune us, cutting away all the old evil habits, the fleshly tendencies, that, Lord, you would enable us to persevere to the very end as we bear the maximum fruit harvest. Lord, we ask that we would be able to see your work, the Father's pruning and the Spirit's growth in our lives. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's respond to the word by taking our hymnal, turn to hymn 476 as we stand and sing, It Is Well With My Soul.
now God's good word to you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.